If you would, take your Bible or your Bible app and meet me in Ephesians. Paul's letter to the Ephesian church. It's going to be a while before we get there. So as I'm talking and introducing things and setting everything up, if you're like, dude, when are you going to get to Ephesians? Just bear with me. It's going to take a little while. So I was recently shocked to find out that there is actually an academic peer-reviewed journal called the Journal of Happiness Studies. It's a series of research projects that aims to learn what makes human life flourish, what produces joy in the human heart. And when they look at what distinguishes happy people from unhappy people, they came up with something that caught me off guard. There's a major difference, and only one major difference, one discernible difference between happy people and unhappy people. And so what I want us to do, take about 20 seconds and tell the person next to you what you think it is. Go. Okay, so I'm going to tell you what it is. And you can see whether you were right or the person next to you was right or both of you were wrong. It's not income. It's not how much money you make. It's not health. It's not what shape your body is in. It's not security. It's not attractiveness. It's not your IQ. It's not career success. Here it is. What consistently distinguishes healthy, happy people from less happy people is the presence of deep, safe, meaningful relationships with other human beings. That is it. According to their research, and this is on your outline, if you turn your bulletin over and follow the listening guide, isolation breeds despair. Connectedness leads to joy. That line was lifted straight out of the Journal of Happiness Studies. Isolation breeds despair. Connectedness leads to joy. Now, that's not news to God. I was caught off guard. God, I promise you, was not. He designed us to live in connectedness to each other. In the creation story in Genesis, we read that God created human beings, and shortly after that, in Genesis 2:18, he says, "It is not good for man to be alone." There was a sense of incompletion, unfinished business. Something was missing, so he made another person. In the first story of the first book of the Bible, God makes sure we hear him say with his own voice that we were created for community. And I know some of you go it alone, introverts are like, yeah, I'm not real sure about that. I'm not going to buy into this community thing. And you know, there's actually lots of research being done right now about how difficult it is for a church to meet introverted people where they are. I was with a neighbor this past week, and he's in a season of life where crisis has come. And you know, crisis has a unique way of taking us deeper and opening our eyes to seeing what's real. And the desperation factor goes up, and that's a really good thing. Desperation is not a curse. It's a gift. And so this guy is feeling desperate for God, but he's been disconnected from God's people for 30 years. And I said, so you like God, you love Jesus, you're into spirituality in a vague sense, but what is it about church? And he said, I'm introverted and crowds. And he came up in a really traditional church setting. And so big Sunday school classes, he said, I can't go there. And so if you're kind of like that, and you're like, I like God, and I'm really into God, and you know, I like worship music, and I love the Bible. I love the truth, but I'm not real sure about relationships, and I'm already feeling uncomfortable because of all this fuzzy, warm, emotive language he's using. Just hang with me, okay? I'm building a case here. This is important to see here, really important, because connectedness is not the same as knowing a bunch of people or having lots of contacts in your cell phone. It's not the same thing as having lots of Facebook friends or Twitter followers. We can be in lots of conversations and remain disconnected. We can have droves of contacts, but no real connections. I'll tell you how central this is. There's a British researcher by the name of David Winnicott who made a fascinating discovery about kids. Track with me on this. He found that children who play in close proximity to their mom are more creative in their playing than children who play a long ways away. He found out that children are naturally inventive and curious and free in what might be called a circle of connectedness. And when they stay in the circle and they can see their mom and they're with other friends, they take risks. They're liberated from their inhibitions. If they fall down, they're more resilient. They get up. They laugh more than children who are isolated. And then when they're outside the circle, they turn into different people. They're different, fearful, insecure, unsure. Now, why is that? It's not that the mom is doing all this special stuff. She's not solving any problems for the kid. She's not generating any ideas for what the child ought to be doing to play effectively. All she's doing is she's there. She's just there. Something gets released when the mother is there. The kid grows stronger. They become bolder. They're more creative. They're set free. It's love. There's no love like a mama's love. Love is creating life in that child that would otherwise remain dormant. And when we're loved, it's not that we get more of somebody else. It's that we become more of ourselves when we are loved. It's like this life inside of us breaks forth, and love is what releases it. And all of us, if we're totally honest today, even if you're introverted and shy and predisposed to isolation, if you could show all your cards, and I know all the extroverts, I can speak for you because I'm extroverted off the charts to a fault. We all, regardless of personality type, no matter what you are on the Myers-Briggs or the DISC or whatever else you've taken, we all desire real connections with other people. We all want it. Nobody flourishes when they stand alone. Nobody. Nobody overcomes a struggle when they stand alone. Nobody experiences a deep life with God just by standing alone. That's why here at Harpeth, and hear me clearly, we want to be the kind of church where nobody stands alone. Not anybody. Regardless of your spiritual baggage or your background, regardless of how heinous you think your sins of the past are, regardless of whatever you've been through or what wounds you carry, we want to be the kind of church where nobody stands alone. Let me share something with you that you may not know. If you do know this, I hope your spirit is strengthened. And if you don't know this, I pray that you are blown away and changed forever. I want to talk to you about some fundamentals of what it means to be the church, blocking and tackling kinds of stuff. This is Christianity 101. You can go to church all your life and actually miss this. That's why I want to take us through this. And if you've never heard it, I'm really glad you're here. But before I go there, I need to set it up just a little bit, and I need you to track with me because there's a really sweet moment in this message, and I don't want you to miss it. You're going to think I'm going off on a tangent, but I promise I'm not, okay? You okay with that? All right. So most of the New Testament is made up of letters. So when you read the New Testament, you're reading other people's mail. A federal offense. The letters were written mainly by a guy named Paul, who was the world's first church planter. He plants churches in cities like Colossae and Ephesus, and after a new church is planted and it was firmly established with gospel-centered leadership, he went to another city and planted a church there. This was really hard work, but this was explosive, and the Holy Spirit was all over it, and Jesus was presiding over it. The leaders of those churches that he planted would communicate with him in writing after he left. We have no record of those writings, but we do have in record Paul's responses, and that's what you have in your New Testament. He would hear back from those leaders, and then he would write to address the problems and issues that he heard about. Based on what we have, here's what we can safely say about the churches Paul planted. They were full of real people with real problems and real fears who were struggling to trust and follow Jesus in their day. They faced cultural pressure and persecution from those in power. And some of this persecution was intense and scary. And even though the world has changed a lot since the first century, we are them. So if you look at the Bible and you're like, that's so ancient, it's culturally disconnected, I don't know those people, it wasn't even written in English, it was Greek and Hebrew, and you see all of these barriers between you and the Bible, understand this, people are people. People are people. We are real people with real problems and fears and cultural forces that tempt us to cave and crumble under the pressure. The world has changed, but people are people. Do you agree with that? So Paul wrote his letters to encourage them to stay the course and endure the trial and push through the temptation. In letters like Galatians and Colossians, Paul warns the people not to be swayed by the folks who came in after Paul left and tried to distort the gospel message. The biggest threat to those churches, to the mission of God in those cities, was not the surrounding pagan culture. It was the false teachers who came in and twisted Paul's message. That's critical to understand. It's very important. Because here's where we're going. As I attend conferences and read books and listen to podcasts, I am becoming increasingly disturbed by the most prevalent message that's people are paying $400 or $500 to go to these conferences and buy books and download the podcast. When I listen to the pastors who are celebrated, and God is doing a lot of good things, but I'm becoming concerned. And this is going to come right into our neighborhood here, so track with this. And this is on your outline. As I see it, the most popular message, and by popular I mean what's selling books and what's getting traction in the cultural Christian world, goes something like this. God is holy. We are not. Try harder to be a good Christian. God is holy. We are not. Try harder to be a good Christian. And if it's a book about discipleship, which is a word we use a lot around here, some of those books are God is holy, we are not, try harder to be a good Christian, and then get other people to try hard to be a good Christian. And the problem with this is that you are at the center of it. This is not the message of the Bible in any regard, but it's kind of scary because those statements are true. God is holy. Without the saving intervention of Jesus, we are not. And it is good to put forth effort to grow spiritually. That's what's so destructive about this, is that there's a little truth here. There's a lot of truth there. But when you say this is the essence of living the deeper Christian life, I think it's fundamentally flawed, and it can do great damage to your soul. In every letter Paul wrote to those struggling churches, he pretty much said the same thing, and this is where Paul's genius comes in. He took them back to the original gospel message, and this is what he said on your outline again. He starts off with the same thing. This is what God has done in Jesus. This is what God has done in Jesus. He put forth a sacrifice of atonement, provided forgiveness of sins, and we have been transferred from a kingdom of darkness and into a kingdom of light. Jesus stood in our place, carried our shame and our guilt. He bore the consequences, the eternal, the horrible consequences of our rebellion against God. He was resurrected 3 days later and claimed victory over humanity's most feared enemies, sin, death, evil. Jesus defeated all three of them. Sin, death, and evil are no match for God. This is what God has done for you in Christ. And now, this is the part we leave out the most. We do death, we talk about the death of Jesus and the resurrection, but the enthronement and the ascension of Jesus. Now, he is at the seat of honor, at the right hand of the Father, and he is ruling and reigning and is supreme over all creation here and now. That's the part we forget. This is what God has done for you in Christ. Now here comes the second part. Because this is true, this is who you are. This is who you are. You are God's child, his offspring. You bear his image and therefore reflect his heart to those who don't yet know him. Because of what God has done in Christ, you are God's masterpiece, created in Jesus to do good works. Because of what God has done in Christ, you are a new creation in Christ. The old is gone, the new is come. You are more than a conqueror through him who loves you. You are the salt of the earth. Do you know one of the most ancient purposes of salt was to arrest decay in meat? And so they would rub salt into meat, and what was going bad would suddenly turn around and get better. Can you imagine? Can you see this image of God pressing his people into the cracks of society and where things are dying and they're coming back to life? You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. The world is dark, and we are the light. Because of what God has done for you in Christ, this is who you are. Now, here's the last part. Because of all of this, become who you already are. This is what God has done for you in Christ. Because that's true, this is who you are. Now, in light of those things, become who you already are. The Christian life is not about striving to become someone you're not. It's about becoming who you already are. That bears repeating. And in the first century church, there was verbal affirmation, amens and yeses, and statements of agreement. And when I say something that resonates with your soul like this, at least wink at me or something, okay? Because what I just said, and I know I'm a flawed messenger, and there's 100 reasons why you should never listen to me, but, and I'm not going to go into that right now. So, but here's the deal. I'm a broken man. I have nothing to say to you. I am heralding a message that's not mine. This is the message of Jesus. And if it resonates with your spirit, let's say it. Okay, so here I'm going to read this again. And I may just stay here and just keep reading. I don't know, because this is earth-shattering news. It really is. The Christian life is not about striving to become somebody you're not. It's about becoming who you already are. See Ephesians and Colossians. Read this for yourself. Don't take my word for it. Go home, pore over the word of God, and discern this pattern and lift it up, and you will see that's what Paul was doing. This is what God did for you in Christ. In light of that, this is who you are. Now, walk this way. Become who you are. Don't strive to become somebody you're not. When you're in Walgreens and you see those scantily clad women on those magazines, you don't say, oh, I want to be holy, so I won't go there. You don't say that. You say, no, because God has made me holy. Holy people don't go down there and look at those women. Difference. Do you understand the difference in the mindset? And when I go home, and if my wife pushes a button, which she would dare never do, but if she did, I'm not going to say, well, I've got to overcome this anger. I'm going to strive and white knuckle and push my way through this, and I'm going to become someone who's not angry. And I'm going to say, look, the Holy Spirit has given me access to the greatest power in the world, and this is my wife. I'm not going to blow up at her, because that's not what Jesus would do. And you know what? We live by the power of an indwelling Lord. If you trust and follow Jesus, Jesus lives in you. And you don't have to drum up all this power. The power is already there. Jesus told the woman at the well who was addicted to relationships, she was a serial relationship kind of person, mortally wounded. We don't know her background. We don't even know her name. But we have the conversation. Jesus goes to a well. It's in the wrong town, the wrong woman, the wrong place. Jesus has broken so many social rules. So many social faux pas have been crossed. And Jesus goes to her and he says, I'm going to put in you living water, an eternal spring, a wellspring, and it's going to go wherever you go. And whenever you need a drink, you can take a big gulp. Those are my words. That's my translation. But if you think somehow the power you need is out there, it's in here. It's been deeply implanted in you. And the secret of life is learning to live from the inside out. Not the outside in. Outside in is Pharisaism. Control those external behaviors. Don't do this, don't do that. Be this kind of person. Stop it. Jesus says, become who you already are. And stop believing the lies that you're not this or you're not good enough or you don't measure up. Well, join the human race. We didn't measure up. Otherwise, Jesus would not have had to die. And now, because Jesus has stood in our place and raised victoriously from the dead, we are joint heirs. We are his sons and daughters. And what the Father was for Jesus, Jesus is for us. So I want to look at Ephesians now. I'm glad you're there. I'm going to go quickly here. So just track with this and let's go. Verse 3 of chapter 1, I'm going to show you this pattern. I'm building a case. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Are you seeing the pattern already? This is what God has done for you in Christ. We're starting there. For he chose us in light, remember, in light of that, this is who you are. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless. In love, he predestined, he predetermined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with the pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he freely has given us in the one he loves. In him we already have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished. I love the word lavish. He didn't just kind of give a little bit. He lavished it on us with all wisdom and understanding. Now go to chapter 2, verse 1. There's dynamite here. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work and those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at once, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. And here's the great verse. Here's the turn. Verse 4, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive in Christ, even though we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. In other words, one day there's going to be a parade. It's a resurrection parade. And the trophy cases are going to be full, and we will be the trophies. He's going to show everybody, this is what grace can do to a human being. Look at all these people. They were dead, and now they're alive. It is by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. We are God's workmanship, created in Christ to do good works. Flip over to chapter 4. You've heard this is what God has done in Christ. Because that's true, this is who you are. Now watch this. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling that you've received. Become who you already are. Be completely humble and gentle. Because of this is true, be patient. Because this is true, bear with each other in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. There is one body, one Spirit. Go over to verse 15. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its worth. Now here's the thing about that verse 15. Speaking the truth in love, we typically use that verse to talk about correcting a brother. But let me tell you something, brother. I got a problem with what you're doing. I don't see anything here about conflict resolution. If you can find that verse or even the slightest turn of phrase to suggest that's about conflict, show me afterwards. I'll give you my take on this. And I'm about to land this plane, I promise. When it says speaking the truth in love, what he's saying is this is what it means to be the church. Just like I came in and planted this church, Paul says, and I founded it on this message, this is what God has done for you in Christ. Because that's true, this is who you are. Now, become who you already are. Now you tell each other that and keep this message in front of each other. That's what it means to be the church. when you drift away from this, it is my responsibility as your brother to speak the truth in love. And there is no limit to the power of those words. I walked into a men's group a few years ago, the first men's group I had ever been to. I thought they were around a campfire singing Kumbaya, all the stereotypical men's group. I thought that's what they were doing. You know what they were doing? They were doing Ephesians 4:15. I walked in. I had just broken a promise to God that I had made what seemed like 1,000 times the night before. I had disappointed myself and my wife. I had gone back on my word. I was filled with shame. I walked into this men's group, and a brother comes up to me that I know very well and hold in high regard, and he said, "Josh Patrick, Jesus loves you, and you're a good man." The Christ in me stood up because what he said was true. And the night before, I had deviated from my identity, and he reminded me. It was Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the martyr, who wrote the famous book, Life Together. He said this. He said, "When I am with another brother or sister in Christ, the Christ in him awakens the Christ in me." That's the church. That's why we have home groups. That is why we have Celebrate Recovery. That is why we get together. We don't just get together to meet because we're religious people in the South. And that's what we do. There's a big, big purpose for this. Because for the Christ in me to be awakened, I have to be with the Christ in you. And the indwelling Lord in me will stand up when he encounters the indwelling Lord in you. This is what God has done for you in Christ. Because this is true, this is who you are. Now become who you already are. Walk this way and live this way. We are to speak those words to each other, people. We are. Jesus said, "Where two or more are gathered in my name," and what it means, in my name, for the explicit purpose of encouraging one another to trust and follow me, I am there among them. Everyone longs to be fully known and fully loved. Do you agree with that? Everybody needs and wants that. Tim Keller has this great quote. I've put it on your outline. "To be loved but not known is comforting but superficial. To be known and not loved is our greatest fear. But to be fully known and truly loved it's like being loved by God. It is what we need more than anything. It liberates us from pretense, humbles us out of self-righteousness, and fortifies us for any difficulty life can throw at us." Fully known and fully loved. Gigi Butler, a beloved member here, was kind enough to tell her story about what being a part of a home group has done for her and how Jesus got to her in the context of authentic biblical community. I'd love for you to see her story.
What would I say to people that are hesitant to join a small group? I think I would be the epitome of that person. Brother Bobby would come up to me every Sunday and say, "You need to join a home group, you need to get involved." And I finally said, "Back off, you're bugging me. I need some space to think about this." I really thought about it, and he was okay with that. I don't think I offended him when I said that, but I just needed time to think about this as a commitment. And once I did, I gained all the family and all the fun and all the sometimes sad times and hard times that we work through things together. But it is a commitment. I think that's something that people are hesitant about. It's a commitment, but with the commitment comes a lot of reward. How I've experienced Jesus in our home group is the first time I entered this building, I experienced Jesus. I was broken and single mom and looking for a new church home, and Brother Bobby was the first person I saw, and he welcomed me and made me feel so comfortable, and his wife Cindy just enfolded me and accepted me and my daughter, and we've been friends ever since. And that's how I experienced Jesus, was just the kind people here that want to be a team. And I think the home groups are kind of like a team player. You have to be a team player. And sometimes being an outsider or being by yourself and being a single mother, you don't have a lot of the team player attitude. And being in a home group is a commitment. But it's a great commitment because it helps you become accountable and it helps you have a family. You have to commit to have a family, and the same way is with the home group. You commit when you have a family and they become a family. I know that for me and my daughter, Kendall Sky, that we have a family that we can lean on. They can encourage us. They can go with us through the hard times and the great times. And that she has a family, a spiritual family that loves her. And she'll have that stability for the rest of her life. Hi, B-Bobby.
Hey, B-Bobby.
In the beginning when I started coming to the church, I would hear home group, home group, home group. And I was like, back it up with the home group thing. Give us some space if you're bugging me. But now that I'm in a home group and I am committed, I really want to say to people, you need to be fed on a Wednesday night or Thursday night or once a week by your church family. And it's hard to be fed by your church family just coming to service every Sunday. You need that time during the week to get fed and to tell people your problems and know that you're not the only one who's having a hard time in life. But it is important, and now I realize that. And I was the number one hesitant person to not join a home group. But now I know it's the best thing for me and my daughter.
This is why we make such a big deal about living in community with each other. Real relationships require investment and risk. You've got to make an investment. You've got to take a risk. We live in a crazy culture that says settle for faux friendships and Facebook friends. Why do you think the TV shows Cheers and Friends and Cosby? I'm looking at some, these are older shows, but some of the greatest shows ever, Seinfeld, on and on and on, Community and 30 Rock. I could go on. I'm not a real TV watcher like I used to be. But those shows are so popular because in America, what we do, rather than enter into real friendships, we watch other people pretend on TV to have friendship. And we love it. And that's why the church exists, because in every heart is a desire to be fully known and fully loved. It requires investment. It requires risk. There's a yellow card on the seat in front of you. It's a home group sign-up sheet. The front page, it lists the groups. Some are closed and some are open. Our data tells us that 70 to 80% of our members are in a home group. And just so you know, that is way, way higher than the national average. And we're really happy about that. Pleased, grateful to God for that. But there's 20 to 30% of you who still are settling. And if this is church, you're only getting a small piece of the pie. The good stuff is in real relationships. So I hope you'll allow the Lord to push you over the edge a bit and sign up and come to the connections desk. I'll be back there after service. I would love to talk to you. And if you're a regular guest, if you're just flirting with the idea of trusting and following Jesus and you're not real sure, we would love to have you come and walk into your life. You walk into ours. We're just really glad that you're here. Biblical community is the ideal environment for sustained life change. If you want to change deeply, you'll have to do it with some friends. Community is where we recover from the effects of sin. Community is where we support and walk with each other through struggles. Community is where God does his most dramatic work. And I pray that you'll experience it this year in a home group. Jesus, I pray that in this time that some folks who are hesitant, who have been hesitant about community, would just go all in. And I pray for people who may be thinking about walking out of a group or living in isolation for a season. I pray that you would help all of us see that the impulses within us that drive us to isolation are not from you, from our fallen nature. Oh, Lord, help us to be open books. Help us not to pretend to love each other. Help us to really love each other well and invest. The rewards and the investment in spiritual maturity will be far beyond anything we could ever ask or imagine. We We pray in Jesus' name.